This guy bought a piece of waterfront property in Miami for $15.5 million. And 22 years later, sold it for $363 million.
3, 2, 1.
Adventures in Miami Real Estate.
Forget the traffic, forget the never-ending road work. People come to Miami to indulge and enjoy everything it has to offer. That's what Miami's all about, and that's what we're here to talk about. This is Adventures in Miami Real Estate. My name is Mark Zilbert, and I'm your host. If you're joining us for the first time, this is a podcast that's sort of about real estate, but really more about life in and around Miami. So we'll talk about real estate, but we also love to dig into the social scene, the dining scene, and everything else that makes Miami, well, the greatest place on earth. My guest today is a rising star in Miami real estate. Not only is he a good friend, but he actually grew up here, one of the few people I know that actually did. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to introduce you to David Vasquez.
Thank you, Mark. It's a pleasure to be on.
David, welcome, welcome. So folks, David and I have worked together for many years. A few years back, David ventured out on his own and he's doing so incredibly well. So David and I have an interesting history together. Originally, he called me to come work for me. My company then was Zilbert Realty Group, which now it's just called Zilbert. And I was a tough guy. I mean, I wouldn't just take anybody. I kind of wanted, you know, someone to have a name and a reputation out there. So I got a lot of phone calls at the time. And I think first time around, actually, I don't think we even spoke. I think I had my assistant kind of do an initial screening and then sent you off, and which I regret now, obviously. But what happened after that?
So yeah, after that, if you fast forward 2 years, you know, I was working at another brokerage and, you know, kind of got my feet wet a little bit more. I was just starting to get some deals done. You know, I was very young at the time. I came straight out of college and I was basically working as a realtor when I was 22, 23. So didn't have many clients at that point. But I was doing my master's at FIU in real estate. And that's when I met one of your team members, and he kind of brought me in to work with him. And because he was working at Zilbert Realty at the time, I was then able to kind of come in under his wing. And that's how you and I connected really for the first time. And that started my career at Zilbert.
Well, I do recall, you know, one thing that I think I've had a good knack for in the past is spotting good talent and really understanding who will do well in this business. And as we know, real estate, it's a tough, tough business. There's a lot of people looking to get in the business, and going back a couple of years, I mean, you know, when I got started in the early 2000s, I mean, everybody had a real estate license and everybody was jumping in the game, and it was quite easy. The buyers were flocking and buying and reselling and flipping. It was kind of nuts. But as the years moved on, it became a lot more challenging. And there are a lot of people that started in the last few years, let's say the last 10 years, that just gave up because it's a very competitive marketplace. And more importantly, the clients that we have, the buyers that come to town or the sellers that are looking to list properties, they really want to deal with the best. So the skill set of someone they're going to talk to is very important. And so when I interview people or meet people or work with people, there's an instinctive part of me that says, this one will do well, this one won't do well. And, you know, the fact that I kind of rejected you the first time sort of came back on me because I missed a couple of great years working with you. But once you were on board, and especially since you went on your own, it's just amazing how the business has found you. And there are a lot of people that are still struggling. So I'm really happy to see that your growth in this business has been, I mean, it's been on an upward trajectory nonstop since. And we've done some amazing deals together. And David is part of the Zilbert network. And even though David works for a different firm, I have a network of brokers and agents from different companies that participate in Zilbert.com. And the way that works is we have a lot of traffic that comes through the website. And as clients come through, I'll work with some of them, but sometimes the load of clients is too big just for me. So the folks that are my network, David being one of them, will take on some of the business and work with them collectively with me. And it's an amazing experience. So it's a great way to be working with other brokers in the business who aren't necessarily working for me. And it's a great collaboration. So As far as Miami goes, and we're going to talk more about some specific real estate and some of the goings on, but generally, overall, now that we're getting to 2024, what do you see happening? We're going to talk about some of your deals a little bit later on, but in general, what's happening in the market? Where are the buyers? Are there buyers? Who's selling? Are the prices sort of out of control still? Just in a couple of quick sentences or phrases, you know, what are we seeing?
So, you know, I get asked this question like all the time, right? And right now it's a very tricky, interesting market because there's so many different factors going on, which changed with rates going basically from 3% mortgage rates to almost 8%, then now back to hovering around 7, high sixes for the last 6 to 8 months, right? What I see is inventory being very low. There are buyers out there. Is there this flock of buyers that we saw in 2021 and 2022? It's not to that amount. But for the amount of listings that are on the market, there is still a healthy amount of demand. The problem that has been, because prices did go so crazy, sellers think that it's still this kind of market for every property. So a property that needs work, they're going to list it at top dollar. And then because buyers now are a little bit more conscious because their monthly payment is significantly higher, these properties are now like sitting on the market. Last year, we survived the interest rate hike from 3% to 8%, the banking crisis in the first quarter of 2023. There was a lot of scares. The economy, everyone thought the economy was gonna go down and we were going to go into recession. And prices still rose in Miami from 4 to 5%. Appreciate it.
It's amazing, too. In the 20-plus years I've been selling real estate, I've noticed Miami seems to always buck the national trends. And whenever we think something's not going to do well, it does. And I think part of that is because we are a destination. We are a luxury destination. And I know, and you know as well, a lot of our clients that we work with aren't necessarily locals, but they want a place in Florida. I think what's happened in more recent years is we've seen, for a lot of different reasons, but we've seen an incredible slew of people from New York, California, especially California. We didn't see as many as we saw from past years, but there's a lot of people leaving the state for different reasons. We are seeing also post-COVID, Europeans, South Americans. You know, COVID was really tough for all of us, and I didn't quite know what the outcome would be because sometimes when there's a lull, I mean, that's more than just a lull, that's, you know, full stop. But sometimes when a market, an economy goes through a full stop, it just never recovers, never comes back again. With that being said, once we were into the pandemic a few months, I remember the showing started again and we did masks and gloves and the hand goo and everything, but we did showings and things kind of picked up again. And it kind of got very quickly back to, I would say back to normal. I mean, the activity really picked up. I thought we'd be a year or two out, but it was really just a matter of months. But then again, you know, Miami opened up pretty quickly anyway. But when it comes to buyers forking huge dollars, it kind of never ends. You know, I had another episode with a colleague of ours, Lisa, the other day, and in that episode, we talked just about how I think there were some 70 new development projects, 42 of them had starting prices of $1 million, which is just amazing. So I think Miami will always be Miami, you know, barring some unforeseen circumstance, you know. But I want to segue because when we're talking about Miami and why this is so popular, we do have these incredible events that come around. Now, I know Ultra Music is coming to town, and I wouldn't necessarily say the Ultra Music crowd is the luxury crowd that we work with. With that being said, Ultra Music, it's such a massive event that it does keep Miami on the map for a lot of different reasons. And I remember when I had my place in South Beach. Now, Ultra Music is a festival that's in downtown Miami. I could hear the festival from South Beach. That's how crazy it was. So, but, you know, I'm kind of at the age, I don't necessarily go to the festival. But, you know, what When is that happening this year? That's like the end of the month, isn't it?
Yeah, so it's the second to last weekend of March, March 24th through the 27th, I want to say. It happens there at Bayfront Park. They've been doing it at Bayfront Park with the exception of like one COVID year for, I would say, a long time, almost a decade now. And I believe next year is their 25-year anniversary. So I think they're going to make like next year like a really big deal. I mean, look, I've had my share of going to Ultra back in my younger days. It's still fun. You know, if I get invited, I may go from time to time, but I haven't been in a few years. But really what makes Ultra like such a huge deal, I mean, besides the artists, of course, but that sunset hour, which is now with the time change, like 7:30, 7:45, 7 p.m., and the Miami skyline backdrop right in the back as the sun is setting, it's like incredible with thousands of people. I mean, that's what makes it.
I do love the music. And ironically enough, even though, you know, I mean, my music taste is very diverse. I saw a list of some of the DJs here, Calvin Harris, DJ Tiesto, David Guetta, Hardwell, Armin van Buuren. These are actually names that I know. I recognize these. And the music is fantastic. I would imagine a lot of the people that live along Biscayne Boulevard probably, you know, take the week off or weekend off and go do something else. It must be quite loud to be living there. But, you know,
I actually used to live. So there's a few buildings that are like right across the street. The number one building there is 50 Biscayne. It's like front row seats to the main stage. So anyone that's facing east that lives in 50 Biscayne has literally the best seats in town. Then you have Vazquez, which is a building that I lived in years ago. I would leave town, you know, go to the Keys, take a little weekend trip just because the traffic, there's a lot of road closures. So the traffic could be a little bit crazy that weekend.
That's amazing. I noticed, I caught a note here. The ticket prices start at about $350. Wow, that's a lot of money. Maybe I'm out of touch. I don't know.
I know. Not the same as when I was going. Probably when I was going, it was like a third of that. Who knows?
That's amazing. Also, another big thing this month is the Miami Open. So I don't follow tennis. I mean, the Miami Open is a big, big thing here. But what's the deal with that? And that's at the Hard Rock Stadium, right?
So Miami Open, I do love. This is where it used to be like the Sony Ericsson Open back in the day, and it was out of Key Biscayne.
On the Keys, right? Biscayne. Yeah,
Key Biscayne. But then I think like maybe 3 or 4 years ago, they moved it to the Hard Rock, and everyone was like very bummed out about that because it was always like a special kind of energy of going to Key Biscayne and watching tennis in Key Biscayne. But what the Hard Rock has done, the facility and the whole setup that they've done, the venue that they set up there for the Open is, I mean, way better than anything we could have imagined compared to what Key Biscayne offered. I mean, the Hard Rock in general, they host the Miami Open, Formula One. They moved the whole Dolphins facility on the site. So it looks like almost like an amusement park now if you go to the Hard Rock Stadium.
There's even a gondola there, right?
They have like a sky gondola. I mean, obviously the racetrack, which now the Formula One is first week of May. So they're getting ready for that because that's a big build out. But the Miami Open is incredible. It's the last 2 weeks of March. It's probably, you know, outside the major tennis tournaments, probably the fifth or sixth biggest one. Some people could debate over that. But we'll see some top talent. Last year I went a few times. This year I'm already planning on going again. And it's a great time if you want to just spend the day there. You know, they have great food, great drinks. So I love it. That I will be attending.
I noticed that Bodega has a setup there, which is
very famous. Your spot.
Street food, tacos. I love that. So yep, Fuku yep. Chicken is there. Cheeseburger baby. Well, there goes my diet, right?
Yeah. I mean, anytime I need a Mexican recommendation, I know I'm always calling you, Mark. Regardless of where I am in the world.
That's right. That's so true.
I think gave me a taco recommendation in Paris, actually.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. One of my favorite Mexican places anywhere is in Paris. Imagine. But hey, David, also, I want to, I caught a news story recently. So billionaire Ken Griffin, who runs Citadel Securities, I think a lot of people know, he moved Citadel to Miami. It was in Chicago. It's been in Miami for 2 years. And he's been buying a lot of personal real estate up in Palm Beach. But there was a recent story about a building that he's going to construct for Citadel for $1 billion. And what can you tell us about that? Have you seen that story?
I feel like Ken Griffin is buying up everything in the world right now. I mean, from Palm Beach to New York City, I think he bought like one of the most expensive properties in London. And then now like his latest favorite city is Miami, of course. And it feels like he's buying a new piece of property every other day. I mean, from the sites in Brickell, which is the one that you're referring to he bought a home here on the Bay for over $100 million last year as well, which he's going to be residing in that property. But he's, you know, tearing down the home and going to be building his primary residence there. But yeah, the property you're referring to, so he is moving he already moved his headquarters to Miami. And they're currently right now at 200 Biscayne, which is a class A office building in downtown Miami. That's their current headquarters. In the meantime, once 830 Brickell, which is a brand new office building, which was supposed to be done last year, 2023, hopefully it gets done this year. They have a full, I think, maybe three or four floors there. And they're going to be set up there until he builds this $1 billion office headquarters that's right on the Brickell Bay. It's going to be one of the tallest buildings in Brickell, and it's going to be a mixed-use project. I mean, I think it's going to be hotels in the top floors, which will have like insane views. Yeah, crazy. It's going to be office, of course. There's going to be retail. So it's going to be an amazing, amazing office. And the success that 830 Brickell had, which is like the last Class A office building built in Brickell, they've been fully leased for like 3 years, way ahead of like even completing the building. So I think they had so much success that he probably sees, well, you know, I'm going to build my headquarters here, then I could also lease out, you know, all the rest of this office space, which is direct water view, by the way. That site was always supposed to be for residential, as you know.
Yeah, what was the owner of that Florida East Coast Realty, that's Tubor Hollow, there was going to be a two-building villa something?
The name changed a few times.
That's right next to where Jade is on off Brickell.
Right.
That's the neighboring lot, right?
Yeah. So it's the empty parking lot that's right next to Jade Brickell on the Bay. It's the last waterfront piece of a property in Brickell. So obviously it had a huge price tag. But yeah, the renderings were always for condos. And it was like a two towers with connecting in the middle somehow. Tibor Hollow owned it, but he bought it for $15.5 million 22 years ago. And then now it's sold for over $300 million in 2022. So not bad.
That's amazing. That's what I call a great real estate deal, the other thing, you know, you don't often find prime commercial buildings sitting along the edge of the water. You know,
correct.
We have great buildings in Miami on Brickell and downtown. They usually set a few blocks in. You know, once you're a few floors up, you get great views.
Right.
But I mean, this is where a condo would have been or could have been.
Right.
So just imagine the offices there. I can't wait to see it. I'm assuming I'll be able to go in and visit.
Yeah. Well, they're going to have the hotel. So maybe you spend the night at the hotel. It's going to be like the 80th, 90th floor. So those views are going to be spectacular.
Wow. That's just amazing. So, I see here. There's an FAA restriction of 1,049 feet. So I would suspect they're going to try to come in at 1,048. I would imagine they're going to build this as tall as they possibly can. And that goes in line with, you know, Jeff Bezos has sort of reestablished himself in Florida. I think, you know, Florida has a great future. I mean, the weather is amazing. Real estate, even though it's expensive, there is real estate at all price points. So it kind of comes down to where do you want to live? What level of luxury are you looking for? But there are a lot of initiatives in place right now to build housing in nice new buildings for regular people, you know, people that, you know, wage workers, hourly workers, civil servants, et cetera. So I think we're going to see a lot of that popping up as well.
Workforce housing.
Yeah, which is very important, because we've seen, I know in past years, we've had people that have, let's say, lived in Homestead, Florida, which is very inexpensive, and commute to South Beach, which is probably, what, 2 to 3 hours daily? Which
with is traffic?
Crazy.
It's a nightmare. 2 hours yeah, with so, traffic, yeah.
You know, but it's good to see that Miami is the place. I wanted to ask you, we all know about South Beach and Brickell and Wynwood and Edgewater and Bal Harbour and all these great places. There is still opportunity, I think, if you look around the South Florida area. Let's focus maybe on Miami, Miami-Dade County. So there are areas that have almost recently started to bloom. There are a lot of plans and developments. And I think for someone looking to buy real estate, it's good to understand where these areas are, because maybe if somebody wants to come down and not spend $5 million, maybe they want to spend $700,000 or $500,000, but they won't have a place here. Some of these up-and-coming neighborhoods will avail that. But in general, where do you see things happening where we can kind of keep our eyes open and follow along?
Yeah. So I think there's a few spots that I really like right now. The first one is not like a shocker, but the north part of downtown Miami, which is right where they're doing this new landmark bridge, which is right where, you know, the 1000 Museum is for Zaha Hadid.
And up by Overtown, so Overtown inwards.
Right. Overtown, exactly. East of Overtown, right? That whole area is going to be, for me, like another Brickell in the next 3 to 5 years. This is where Miami World Center is. This is all part of like the World Center project. World Center is completed, which is a luxury condo high rise. 1000 Museum is completed, where the minimum price point is $7 million, $6.5 million to get in. They have so many developments there, including hotels, condos, mixed use office, and the retail that's coming is really what's going to bring it all. And that's why I think it's going to be like a Brickell. They're making it completely pedestrian friendly. They're going to have some of the best hotels coming there. That they're actually, one is already about to open. Maple and Ash is about to open now, which is one of my favorite restaurants. They're in Chicago. They're in Scottsdale. They just announced, I think today I read, maybe even yesterday, that they're opening an Apple store in downtown Miami.
I read that.
Yeah, there was a lot of speculation about it, but it's confirmed now. So they're going to be opening in that little part. I mean, you have Lululemon open already. You have Sephora open. So it's going to be completely walkable to all those residents that currently live at 900 Biscayne, Marina Blue, 1000 Museum, 10 Museum Park, the Marquee. Right, you know, every year it gets better and better for their walkability, right? Because before, you would live there, you had the best views, but there was nothing downstairs. I mean, maybe like a little coffee shop that wasn't even good. Now, the walkability is actually really good now, but I think it's going to improve like tremendously in the next 3 to 5 years. And I think probably in the last 12 to 8 months, I probably have sold, you know, over 5 or 6 units in that little pocket, just because a lot of people see this vision, the same vision that I'm seeing. So I think that's a huge one.
Yeah. And you know, walkability comes up quite a bit in conversations. And I also want to clarify for people listening, when we talk about walkability, we talk about accessibility and we talk about proximity. These neighborhoods make everything within a block or two. And it's nice to exit your building, go a few blocks, have whatever you want. And David, we're seeing that in pockets. I remember, I think I mentioned to you when Brickell City Center opened, I stayed at the SLS Lux, the hotel part of that condo. And I really hadn't been in that area in quite a few years. I'd driven through, but never to stay and walk around. And just staying at that hotel and walking out the front door and not just having Brickell City Center, but the restaurants. And what's that bakery I love across the street? The
Rosetta Bakery.
Rosetta Bakery. Oh, yeah. Man, amazing. And on top of that, there were just people everywhere. I felt like I was walking in downtown New York. It was just all kinds of people everywhere. And we're seeing that now in all these new neighborhoods. So in a similar way, when you're in Manhattan, for example, and you have districts and every district is sort of a world unto its own, we're seeing those little pockets also appear in Miami.
Yeah, I feel like that area is in the same... You know, Brickell City Center was completed, what, 2015, 2016? Brickell was already kind of pretty popular in 2010, 2011, 2012. There was a lot of residential and offices, but Brickell City Center changed Brickell.
Where else? Where else should we be looking at?
I think another kind of area district for us is North Bay Village, which is, it's literally in the, it's an island between the mainland and the Miami Beach Barrier Island, right? Like North Beach. And right now it's mostly made of single family homes, some multifamily, some apartments, buildings, and a few condos. But no like luxury high-end condos. So they're now announcing, or not announcing, there's already plans in the works for this huge, huge mixed-use project that's going to be retail. I think there's going to be a Whole Foods there, which, by the way, anywhere there's a Whole Foods, like, everyone should flock to. That's always a good sign. So it's going to be retail, restaurants. There are going to be hotels. And then, of course, there's already some luxury condos announced, including one of our favorites, Mark, that you've done a lot of business, I've done a lot of business in, Continuum.
Right. Yes.
So the builder of Continuum South Beach is now going to be building what's called Continuum Club, and it's in North Bay Village. And so I'm actually going there next week with a client to take them to the sales center. And I'm pretty excited about it because it's, you know, Continuum, we love Continuum. We have high expectations for anything that's associated with the Continuum brand. And but, you know, because it's North Bay Village, you're not paying $4,000 a foot, which is what Continuum is in South Beach. You know, two bedrooms are starting 1.4, 1.5. And these are big two bedrooms. These are 1,800 square foot two bedrooms. So I think North Bay Village has a big future ahead of it too.
I agree. And what's great about North Bay Village, it's not far from anything. And as you know, to your point, it sort of connects Miami Beach with the mainland, but from North Bay Village to get to the airport, to get to the beach, it's very easy. And it's kind of a no-brainer. I mean, North Bay Village has been there forever. It just hasn't really been a destination for some folks. And even the local Fox station has a prime waterfront land. They're moving to Miramar, I think, right?
I believe it's Miramar, yeah.
Yeah, so as companies vacate, the land becomes available for residential, for commercial. And I think that's really where the draw is. But I think to your point, with a Whole Foods and a Continuum product, it is going to attract a lot of people. There's also, is it Pagani is the luxury car brand that also announced a new
condo?
In North Bay Village. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. So,
that's
and
incredible.
Again, what I like also about these buildings in North Bay Village, because they have a height restriction, right? You cannot build like 50 stories, 60 stories. So a lot of these buildings are like 25 floors, right? So they're more boutique style. Like the Continuum, for example, is only 189 units. Pagani is going to be something similar, not very big. So it's very boutique style building, which I don't know. I tend to like those usually a little bit more.
It's a little more intimate. Yeah. Yeah. There was a day where for me, even with travel, you know, as you know, I like to go on cruises a lot. There was a day where the more the merrier. Now it's exactly the opposite. The fewer the better, I think, is what my preference is. So what else? Let's pick a third area just to kind of throw a dart at and see what happens.
So if I had to pick one more area, it's a little bit different than like North Bay Village and the downtown area. It's near downtown, Alapata, right? So, and why I say it's different is because it's still more like up and coming. We're like North Bay Village, like you could, in downtown, you could see condos selling well over a million, like even in today's market, like no problem. The new residential luxury pre-construction, that's selling well into the 2, 3, 4, 5 million. Where Alapata is more, so Alapata, just to give you an idea of where it is, you have Wynwood and then I-95 Causeway, and just west of Wynwood is Alapata. But what we're seeing now, because Wynwood is so, has grown so much and it's so pricey, a lot of people, Wynwood is leaking into Alapata. So we're seeing a lot of new development in Alapata. But going back to what you said, like we're seeing a lot of workforce housing stuff there, apartment building, rental buildings. I haven't really been seeing like condos being sold there, but it's gonna be, I think the continuation of Wynwood's growth is going to bleed into Alapata. And I mean, look, Alapata has already been exploding. This is not like news to anyone. But there's still a lot of growth there for the long term.
I think that's going to be an area that is going to completely transform. And I also there, I think there were some federal and state grant programs, I think, to get some things going. But if you kind of look through the news and through some of the public records, you see some very big names, developers, investors putting money into that area. So it'll be really interesting to see what develops. And I think it's going to be fantastic. And I think we are going to be creating yet again another neighborhood where people will just flock to. It'll be very popular. And I think most importantly, it gives everyone a chance to live, you know, close to where they work and not have to, especially at higher interest rates, you know, not have to spend their entire wages just paying for a mortgage.
Yeah. And that's the nice part about Alapata, right? I mean, you're from downtown Miami or Brickell, like let's say you work in those markets, Alapata is what, 10 minutes at most? And then you could get public transportation. You don't even need a car. You could ride bike to downtown.
Well, that's amazing. So David, as a real estate agent, you're out there every day working with buyers, working with sellers. I'm always curious to ask my friends and colleagues, you know, what are you working on right now? What do you have for sale that people would be interested in? And certainly, you know, give you a chance here to plug some of your listings. So what do we have out there right now?
So our favorite listing right now is a single family home in Coral Gables, actually. So it's 185 Cocoa Plum. It's in the neighborhood of Cocoa Plum, which, as you know, is one of the best water. It's one of the best neighborhoods in all of Miami. And then one of the best waterfront neighborhoods in all of Miami. So we have this huge property. It's just below an acre, 37,000 square foot land, with over 250 feet of water frontage. So it's a corner lot. We're listed just below 13 million. It's an incredible, incredible property. It's over 5,500 square feet. And it's actually one of the first properties ever built in Cocoa Plum. I mean, for anyone who wants to be in a neighborhood that's safe, that's guard gated, and that has direct access to the ocean, no fixed bridges, you could fit 100-foot yacht there. It's a perfect fit for that. And then you're in an amazing family-friendly neighborhood, not only Cocoa Plum, but Coral Gables, where you have all the best schools, like amazing right outside the neighborhood. So that is a listing that we've been working on. We've had a lot of interest. We've had multiple, I would say a few offers already at this point. And it's in the works. So let's say that, but it's definitely a stunner.
Wow, sounds amazing. What else do you got?
So aside from that, you know, we have a lot of other listings, a couple condos, a couple single family homes. We're working actively with some buyers. Luckily, you know, we're doing this podcast on a pretty good week because we have a closing today happening as we speak. Actually, it's a closing that we're working together. I didn't even tell you, but Club Atlantis is closing today.
Fantastic. Wow. Actually, that's a nice way to end a week.
It's officially closed already. I was waiting to tell you, but I guess I could tell you now.
Fantastic.
And then next week we have four closings next week as well. So we've been busy. It's been good. But yeah, you know, we're working buyers, we're working sellers, we're renting out properties for our clients. So we're staying busy.
Fantastic. Well, for those of you tuning in, I will put a link to David's page on Zilbert.com and you can review all of his listings and reach out to him as well. David's one of the great realtors in Miami. So if you are in the market, certainly look him up. I think you'll be very happy that you did. You can check out this podcast. The video version will be on YouTube. And for the audio version only, you can check out Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, and most other platforms as well. So I want to thank everybody for tuning in today. Don't forget to check out Zilbert.com. It's updated in real time. I think it's the best real estate website out there. And of course, because I made it, but certainly it's very popular. So until next time, I wish everybody well. And as they say in French, à bientôt, which means we'll see you soon.